The following is an Audio Renaissance presentation.
This is Gene Gendlin. Hello. 25 years ago, at the University of Chicago and in some other places, some colleagues and I began to study some questions. They were questions that most therapists don't like to ask out loud. Why doesn't therapy succeed more often? Why does it so often fail, or fail to make a real difference in people's lives? And in the rarer cases when it does succeed, what is it that those patients and therapists do? What is it that the majority fail to do? In our search for answers, we studied many forms of therapy, classical ones and recent ones. We analyzed thousands of therapy sessions recorded on tape. We did a series of studies that led to several findings. First, we found that successful patients, the ones who show real, tangible changes, both on psychological tests and in life, that these patients can be picked out fairly easily on the tape-recorded therapy sessions. What the successful ones do in their therapy hours is really different from the others. The difference is so easy to spot that once we could define it, we could explain it to inexperienced undergraduates, and they too were able to sort out the successful ones from the others. What is this crucial difference? We found that it's not the therapist technique. Differences in methods of therapy seem to mean surprisingly little. And it's not what the patients talk about. The difference is in how they talk. And how they talk is only an outward sign of what successful patients do inside themselves. During the next 90 minutes, I'm going to tell you what they do and how you can do it. This uncommon skill, this internal act, is a way of approaching any problem or situation. This skill is called focusing. It will let you make little steps of change where your life is stuck, cramped, hemmed in, slowed down. It will enable you to change, to live from a deeper place than just your thoughts and feelings. At the end of this 90 minutes, I'm going to tell you how you can get special help with focusing, how you can find people who already know focusing, and how to contact me and also the Focusing Institute. Now I want to tell you that focusing is the next development after getting in touch with feelings. It concerns a different kind of inward attention, an attention to what is sensed, physically sensed, but at first only unclearly. Then it comes into focus and changes in a bodily way. Before I begin to explain this inner act, I want to ask you please to put aside for a while what you know about psychotherapy and how you usually work with your feelings. Focusing is the next development after getting in touch with feelings. It concerns a different kind of inward attention. It's an attention to what is at first sensed unclearly. It is sensed as a bodily discomfort, as a murky, fuzzy way that the body feels about a certain problem. Then it comes into focus and changes in a bodily way. So it's not the familiar getting in touch with feelings. It is also not the content-free quiet of meditation. People who meditate go directly to a content-free level. Focusing cannot be found on that level. Focusing requires relaxation, but only halfway to the space of meditation. Focusing requires you to keep your body feeding back to you. So, whether you're a therapist, a patient, or a layperson, this inner act is probably quite unfamiliar to you. The internal equipment needed to perform this act is in every person, but most people don't use it. A few do use it intuitively now and then. But the chances are, if this is new to you, you have never deliberately focused, and you haven't been aware of the possibility. Only recently is focusing being discussed in the professional literature. The inner act of focusing can be broken down into six main sub-acts or movements. As you get more practice, you won't need to think of these six separate parts. To think of them separately makes the process seem more mechanical than it really is or will be for you later. But the subdivision into these six steps has served us very well for years in teaching focusing. Later, you will do it naturally and you won't need to be concerned about six separate steps. What I'm going to do now is lead you through these six steps, but I know very well that if focusing is new to you, it's unlikely that you'll be able to do all or even any of them, and that's perfectly all right. As soon as I'm done, I will explain them to you much better, and then, later in the tape, I will take you through them again. I'm doing it now just to give you an overview of what these six steps are, but you can try to do them so that you can see what they feel like to you inside. The first step is called clearing a space. What I'd like you to do is just be silent and take a moment just to relax. All right, now, inside you, I would like you to pay attention inwardly, in the middle of your body, perhaps in your stomach or chest. Now see what comes there when you ask, "How is my life going? What is the main thing for me right now?" Sense within your body. Let the answer come slowly as a sense in your body. When some concern comes, don't go inside it. Stand back and say, "Yes, that's there. That's one thing. I can feel that, yes. That's there, all right." And let there be a little space between you and that. And then ask what else you feel. If it weren't for that, would you be all okay? Wait again and sense. There are usually three or four things. The second step is called getting a felt sense. From among what came, select one personal problem to focus on, and then just choose it. Don't go inside it. Stand back from it a little. Of course, there are many parts to that one thing you are thinking about. Too many parts to think each one alone. But you can feel all these things together. Pay attention in that place where you usually feel things. And in there, you can get a sense of what all of the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.